I want to welcome you here tonight, and I have to say I'm a little surprised. Attendance is light, considering the fact that I think I've heard from you and about 1,000 other people about their concerns about Highway 37. But the good news is that KSVY is here televising the meeting. It will be posted on their website. This meeting is going to be packed full of information. All of the information, all of the great discussions that I've been involved in over the past couple of years. And it is really essential to understand a lot of what these speakers are going to be communicating, to understand the complexity of the situation and the challenges we are faced with Highway 37 each day. Whether you are a resident, or a visitor, or a commuter coming into Sonoma and Napa Valley, yes, you experience a little traffic. If you are Sonoma Raceway, thanks Steve for being here, yes, they are dealing with the challenges of the congestion and the traffic and the dangerous driving behavior that we have going on the highway. It may have been a shock to you, perhaps not to me, that with the rain that we had 27 days of closure on Highway 37 this year alone and in January and February. And we can expect more of that to occur given what we're going to be talking about tonight and the challenges with climate change and bay level rise. But thank you for being here. I really appreciate you being here. I'm Susan Gorin. I'm the First District Supervisor, and I want to thank so many of my colleagues here who have come to visit with us tonight and to give us a wealth of information about Highway 37. Also to let you know that in May, the Sonoma Index Tribune and the Press Democrat, the Sonoma Media Group, will be sponsoring another meeting, and I'm not sure what the date is yet. We'll find that out. And a lot of our elected officials will be here at the time to talk about the political and financial challenges that they are trying to navigate through in order to create the alternatives for the future for our commute. And it's not only our commute. We are experiencing incredibly large increases in traffic on Highway 37 from the simple fact that many of the jobs located in Marin, Sonoma, Napa are accessed by employees living in Solano County. Thus, four counties, Highway 37, 21-mile stretch in Marin, which is where the closures occurred, through Sonoma County, most of the district of David Rabbit, I have about this much of Highway 37 in my district, over to Solano County. Most people don't realize that it skips over Napa, but Napa traffic accesses through Highway 37. So essentially, it is four counties working together. I do want to thank the representatives from various state electeds here tonight. And we have Logan Pitts representing Senator Bill Dodd. Logan, there you are in the back of the room. And Cal Weeks representing Assemblymember Mark Levine. Laura Beltran representing our newly elected Assemblymember Cecilia Aguirre Curry. I always sort of scramble that middle name. I'm sure she's used to it. Thank you so much for being here. And I know that your elected will be here in March, hopefully, if their schedules permit, so we can hear from them directly. I want to thank my folks in my office for helping to assemble this. District Director Pat Gilardi is sitting at the back of the room, and Jennifer Gray Thompson, I believe, is not here tonight. She's actually taking a vacation day or a vacation evening. So let me introduce the panel, and let's start first. I represent you on BCDC. I love acronyms, Bay Conservation and Development Commission. And we have two amazing people from that regional body with us tonight, Isaac Perlman and Eliza Berry. And I'm going to let them introduce each themselves further and give you a lot of information about the great work that BCDC has been doing, and then I'll introduce the next speakers. So take it away.
Great, so thank you Supervisor Gorin for the introduction. As she mentioned, my name is Isaac Perlman. I'm from the Bay Conservation and Development Commission. And it's great to have this opportunity to talk about some of the sea level rise adaptation planning efforts that we've been working on and hopefully give a little bit of the context around some of the work that some of the other speakers will be talking about on Highway 37. So, just out of curiosity, how many people, show of hands, have heard or know of the Bay Conservation and Development Commission? Okay, so pretty fair amount. It's a pretty small agency, so just I wanted to give a little bit of background to our agency, BCDC as we call it. And it was started in 1965 over widespread concern over rapid infill of the San Francisco Bay for development. And since it started almost, a little over 50 years ago now, one of the main drivers of our agency has been to increase public access as well as minimize fill in the bay. And as a result, over 50 years, in 1965, there was about 4 miles of shoreline that the public could access. And today, there's over 200 miles. And every year, through our review of projects and asking proponents to include public access, we've expanded that. BCDC is also the San Francisco Bay's designated coastal zone management agency, which means in addition to our jurisdiction that's given to us by the state legislature, we also have the authority to review federal projects or federally funded projects that have the potential to impact the coastal zone. And we get to use that authority to review those projects and determine consistency with our own state policies. We have a 27-member commission, of which Supervisor Gorin is one of our members. Mr. Dan McElhaney is an alternate on the commission. And these 27 members are composed of all levels of government, coming from local representatives to state agency representatives and federal representatives. And lastly, so our official jurisdiction is designated in the McAteer-Petras Act of 1965. So BCDC has jurisdiction over all tidal waters in the San Francisco Bay, along with what we call the shoreline band, so from mean high tide to 100 feet inland. And the McAteer-Petras Act also designates particular authorities to BCDC in salt ponds and managed wetlands and certain waterways. So that's the background of BCDC, just for the few of you who maybe hadn't heard or doesn't know too much about our agency. But the reason why we're here tonight is to talk about our Adapting to Rising Tides program, which we started in 2011. The planning division at BCDC received grant funds to initiate a pilot assessment in Alameda County to assess the shoreline's vulnerability to sea level rise and future flooding, and evaluate adaptation actions. And so that, like I said, was in 2011. In the past 6 years, that program has grown significantly. And now we pretty much offer adaptation planning services to any local agencies or stakeholders who need adaptation planning support across the bay. We will lead certain adaptation planning processes. We also support other people, like counties like San Mateo and Marin, who have initiated their own adaptation planning efforts. We have supported those. And a big part of our Adapting to Rising Tides, or ARC program, as we call it, is continually refining our assessment approach and incorporating the best available data. Eliza Berry, my colleague, will be talking a little bit about how we do that in particular regards to mapping future sea level rise and flooding. So one of the more recent projects that we're actually kicking off this year that we're really excited about is called ART Bay Area, and that will we receive funding from Caltrans to work with MTC, the Metropolitan Transportation Commission, as well as BARP, the Bay Area Regional Collaborative. We will all be partnering to assess the Bay Area region as a whole, and that assessment for sea level rise, vulnerability, and adaptation actions. That will include evaluating transportation assets, such as highways, railways, airports, seaports, including as well as the Bay Trail. We will also be assessing the priority conservation areas and priority development areas that are identified in the Plan Bay Area. And lastly, we will also be focusing on communities with characteristics that make them vulnerable, especially vulnerable to sea level rise and future flooding, for example, low-income communities. So this project, as I said, it's kicking off this year. We're really excited about it. A big component is going to be public engagement. And so we will be forming a regional working group and working with agency representatives from all 9 counties. But we also really want to, even before we start from the beginning, engage the public as much as possible. So to that end, I would invite any of you who want to learn more, want to participate in this process, please feel free to come talk to myself or Eliza after this, after the panel, and we'd be happy to talk to you and see how you could participate in this process. Lastly, something that Eliza will be talking about, this project is going to be in close coordination with another project called Resilient by Design, and Eliza will talk a little more about that.
Thanks, Isaac. Hi, I'm Eliza Berry. And yes, I'd like to speak to you a little bit about Resilient by Design, the Bay Area Challenge that is launching in May. And so this is a challenge that's supported by our agency among many other partners in the region. And it is a 15-month international design challenge with a goal of really pushing the envelope in terms of adaptation design thinking. So what we'll be doing over the next couple of months is putting together 10 interdisciplinary design teams, architects, designers, planners, teaming them up, and then assigning them to 10 different sites along the San Francisco Bay shoreline and asking them to design projects to address vulnerabilities on that shoreline. So vulnerabilities to current and future flooding, as well as earthquakes. So those design teams will be asked to work closely with communities to come up with innovative ideas to address vulnerabilities while addressing the needs of the local communities. And in terms of the site selection process, the goal will be to have at least one site selected from each of the 9 San Francisco Bay counties. And I know that as this project has developed, there's been a lot of interest in having a site along Highway 37. So we're hopeful that can be the case. And if you're interested in potentially joining a design team or getting involved with the project, please check out the website. There's a form where you can express an interest in getting updates or potentially joining a design team. And I'd also like to talk a little bit about a project that BCDC is carrying out to basically provide the best available data on sea level rise to support the work of Resilient by Design and the work that we're doing on ARC Bay Area. Basically, we can't carry out these sea level rise planning efforts without having the best available data on how sea level rise will affect our shoreline, what areas will flood and when. And so over the last year or so, we have been carrying out a mapping project to show areas at risk from sea level rise and storm events. So these are very fine scale maps that we've created for all 9 Bay counties. They've been thoroughly reviewed by local stakeholders who know the shoreline really well. So here in Sonoma, we've had the Transportation Authority flood managers review our maps to make sure that we're including all of the levees and tide gates and all of the detailed shoreline features. And what's really powerful about these maps is that they show us not only future sea level rise and future permanent flooding from sea level rise, but they also depict temporary flooding that we may see from extreme storm events today. The maps are also very powerful because they help us identify low points in the shoreline that can lead to inland flooding. So these are areas where we might want to allocate the most resources to address the weaknesses in the shoreline. So to just provide one example of how the maps show us future flooding and temporary current flooding. This map shows us high tide permanent inundation from 36 inches of sea level rise in the future. So current projections indicate that we may not see 36 inches of sea level rise until the end of the century. So that's a little bit difficult to know how to plan for that starting today. However, the maps that we're producing under the ARC program show us that this exact same amount of flooding, the same amount of blue inundation that you see on this map is would also be experienced today if we had a 50-year storm. So that's a storm event that's pretty unlikely, but it could happen, and this is what it would look like. Yes?
The slide shows extreme tide, so I'm wondering if you're describing it as a storm, are you referring to the combination of a high tide and a storm event at the same time, or?
It would be a high tide during a storm event.
I see.
Mm-hmm. Thanks. And to elaborate a little bit on what I was saying about how the maps show us low points in the shoreline, we call this the overtopping analysis. So right here is the overtopping depth and a cross-section of the shoreline. So that's the spot where water would flow over the shoreline and lead to the inland flooding, so the pool of water you see. The pool of water you see right there. So looking at the map below, you see the blue areas that are flooded, and then along the shoreline you see all these different colored bands. And the bands that are in red and purple are those areas that are very low. So this spot right here, where my cursor is, that's an area that's very low lying, and we know that if we could address some of the flooding that happens right there, we might be able to prevent the water from flowing inland and causing additional flooding inland and prevent some of this blue flooding from occurring. So in sum, yes?
Can you like cite that map? I'm not even know what I'm looking at.
Okay.
I would say, yeah. Give us some
Okay, so this is Novato.
Is it possible to turn the lights off on the front so we can see the colors?
Yeah. Where is 37?
Yeah, good point. Thank you.
Yeah. Petaluma, Novato, and Sonoma are right here.
So what do you mean a road? We're all underwater.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, San Francisco is going to be underwater. That nobody's going to be traveling to go there anymore to go to work. You're going to build a road for nobody to go on because it won't be anywhere to go to.
Okay. So sorry. Yeah, sorry, I just pulled up the map as an example.
I know the map is alarming to you, and yes, we'll have a discussion about that. If you could save your comments and questions after all the speakers, and then we'll have an opportunity for you to ask your questions and voice your frustrations and concerns. Thanks.
My apologies for not providing more context for the map. I just wanted to use it as an example of the kind of information that we have available for planning purposes. But the point I wanted to make is that these maps are all available for the Highway 37 planning process. We have them available for the whole county and the whole region to support adaptation planning efforts. So that's an overview of some of the efforts that we have going at BCDC to support adaptation planning in the region. And we'll be happy to take questions after the other speakers.
Thank you, Isaac and Eliza. I really appreciate you making the trip up here. And yes, you're right, the images are alarming, which is why I wanted to start introducing the concept to you. Many of you, you're sort of like gray hairs like me, we're not going to live to see the bay level rise, but our kids will, and our grandkids will. I serve on the governing board of the San Francisco Restoration Authority. You are now paying $12 a year in a parcel tax to fund restoration activities around the bay. The dollar signs on the replacement costs and elevation of the significant infrastructure around the bay so far is incalculable. But we have three airports, interstates all around the bay, valuable real estate. BCDC is now starting the discussion with the Restoration Authority about, oh my, we have a really big task ahead of us, and how are we going to approach this? Which is what Eliza talked about with the design contest. We better start now talking about how we're going to elevate. And Highway 37 was slated to be abandoned by BCDC because they just felt it was going to be very difficult to elevate the highway. When they did the analysis of what the rest of the transportation network was going to be like in the Bay Area, they said, oh my, we cannot abandon Highway 37. It's a critical linkage in the Bay Area transportation network. So that's the meeting tonight. And make sure you tell your friends to access the information. We can have lots of additional meetings about this, and we will. It is my pleasure to introduce a colleague of mine, Dan McElhenney from Caltrans. He serves with me on BCDC, and he's a great fellow. He's going to tell you about the work that Caltrans has been doing on Highway 37, not only to reopen 37, but hopefully give us a glimpse of how they are viewing this critical linkage in the future. Dan, thank you for being here.
Good evening, I'm Dan McElhenney. I'm your Chief Deputy District Director for Caltrans here in the Bay Area. We cover the nine counties of the Bay Area, from Sonoma to San Jose, San Francisco to Rio Vista. So thank you for having me part of this panel. I really appreciate it. I have two quick presentations. The first one is just to talk about storm damage. And as you know, since early January, we've had some of the greatest rainfall we've seen in years. So what often happens here in the north part of the Bay Area and throughout the Bay Area is storm damage, because as the roadways and the slopes get saturated, landslides, slip outs, even whole sections of roadway can be flooded, or can actually, as down in Santa Cruz County, we lost 250 feet of State Route 35. Nobody was there when it happened, so that was great. It happened slowly, but eventually 250 feet went downhill, and we're working to move towards repairing that here this summer. This is a quick map that shows we have over 110 locations and nearly $250 million of repair to do. And in Sonoma County, we're tracking 12 different locations. Those in red, I have some sample maps for after the meeting up here on the table. Out of the 12, we have 8 contractors on 8 sites already moving very quickly over the last 8 weeks. And some of those are building soldier pile walls, sheet pile walls, a lot of landslide areas in order to take care of. Some of them only as long as 500 feet, some as high as 25 feet. And so these contractors in the North State, we asked them to join us on an emergency contract. So we go out and assess the site with our geotechnical and engineering team. We develop a quick scope, and the State Contract Act allows us to do an emergency contract. Most of them are emergency limited bid. We reach out to a lot of different contractors, and then we're able to get work started very quickly, and then our environmental team follows up early and through the process with resource agencies, and we usually have some mitigation to follow after the job. So it's a very quick start and follows through with quick repairs for these important routes in Sonoma County. And just for comparison, so in Sonoma County there's 12 sites, about $22 million worth of repair expected. And in Marin County, there's a few more sites, about half of them are still waiting funding. So for those of you that spend time between the counties, there's Marin 1 is still closed on the coast, and that's very common during storm damage years. And we're working diligently to get that open. It is open to local traffic. So in South Marin, on Marin 1, we're very busy on that closed portion of the route. So I want to focus on State Route 37 and why is it helps switch over. You know, District 4 for Caltrans has over 1,400 miles of highways in the nine counties. I want to be sure to thank MTC, our chair, Jake McKenzie's here, and he's an important part of Sonoma County, but he and his team here in Sonoma County are a very important part of the statewide effort for transportation as well as here in the region. And his role, recently selected as chair of MTC, is a great benefit to us all. Supervisor Gorin and Rabbit are excellent team members on the 37 policy group, and I know they're going to be talking more about that and looking at the entire corridor for 37. And of course, Suzanne Smith and her team, including James Cameron, are excellent to work with. And it takes strong partnerships and great teams to advocate for our needs in the Bay Area, which often is in competition with all the needs statewide. So Route 37, for many years, there's great photos all the way back into the 80s where that section of Route 37 continues to be a flooding portion of highway. And that closure this year was more than any of us expected. It gave us an opportunity to evaluate what can we do to solve this, at least considering that with the climate change vulnerabilities and how can we make it more resilient to climate change, we were able to define a project that basically get us up and out of the water and protect us from the bay. So what happened out there, this is an important part of the 37 corridor. As you can see, we're in segment A, and I have some maps that will zoom in on the location. And I know you're familiar with Novato. And so at the 10137, that arrow in blue is Novato Creek. Novato Creek has 45 square miles of drainage basin and six major tributaries, and 17 miles long itself, Novato Creek. And as it heads towards the bay, and with more than 30 solid days of rain, a half inch to 3 inches a day, the creek was definitely in a mode of overflowing as it got close to the bay, close to Route 37. At the same time, as we look at the overall drainage basin, Route 37 isn't ready for what happened next. As the bay waters came up from the bottom, this is a picture north-south, as the tide rose to levels up to 8 feet, this really was quite a super king tide. So Novato Creek had high flows, and what I call a super king tide, that really impacted all the properties around 37, and many of the levees eventually started to have some minor failures, and that contributed to the flooding on 37. So again, that blue arrow is Novato Creek. And this section here is from Route 101 to Novato Creek, was the area of focus. It's really only about 2,000 feet in length. And it's, as most of you, I'm sure, know, that that's an important segment as you first get on the 37 and part of. And what it turned out is it's at least sunk a foot to 2 foot over the years, depending on eastbound and westbound. And I wanted to make sure that our team had a chance to raise the roadway as well as protect it from bay waters. traffic on this route. We want to take a look at what's changed. Just over the last few years, there's more than 4,000 additional vehicles per day. It's 4% trucks, about 1,600 trucks on average per day on the route, so it's a goods movement route. And 3,900 vehicles travel on the route during peak periods in this segment. It's important to help, as we make decisions on where these fundings go, that we be sure that the importance of the route is advocated for. As the king tides were higher than usual, up to 8 feet, that really did impact flooding. So, as Supervisor Gorin mentioned, 27 days of closure. Actually, it was kind of lucky for us. In January, we weren't able to come to a conclusion on the importance of an emergency contract for flooding. For Caltrans, we have a tough time justifying what next to do for flooding. And so we changed our philosophy working with Federal Highways, and we want to make sure that locally and regionally we advocate this is an emergency, and it's affecting all of us on a very important route. And we're able to get at least a really solid decision the second time it closed in early February. And we're able to expedite this emergency contract. Here's some aerial photos of the flooding with the creek, with the blue arrow. Some days were larger flooding than others, up to 2 or 3 feet. You see some of the levees that were breaking, some of the views of the flooded roadway. Unfortunately, some of the travelers got caught coming over from the east and in the middle of the night, and that's when the flooding occurred in early February. Over the years, between the county and the flood control district and Caltrans, we've been pumping water. So that maintainability really didn't give us the service we needed for Route 37. So in January, we presented to the 37 policy group. We wanted to emphasize the importance of these emergency contracts, and we had a lot of local leadership, including the elected here tonight, as well as Senator McGuire, to help again emphasize the importance of finding a solution in the near term and finding the funding. What were we able to do? It closed February 8th. We got the $8 million of budget for emergency contract February 10th. We had a contractor on board, Gelati Construction, and their team was fantastic. It took us a few days to finish a design concept so they can get out and start working. They mobilized right away. But actual construction started February 14th with sheet pile wall and concrete barriers on the eastbound shoulder. And you may see that. It's only about 1,500 feet long, but it provides an additional barrier to the bay tidal influence on the flooding. Raised the roadway up to 2 feet both directions. Gelati Construction and their partners paid 200 tons of asphalt. For those of you who experienced asphalt, who has a lot of asphalt in just a matter of days, and they paid day and night, rain or shine. So they were very impressive. We had inspectors on site 24/7, and they were able to start that work on the 14th and finish that work on February 23rd. Initially, we thought it might take 35 days, and that would be working a lot of nights. With their innovation and our team's design during construction to adapt, basically 9 days of construction. So we're very proud of that effort, and that effort by Gelati Construction. There's a number of an ABSL asphalt grinding, as well as Apex Fence, Pacific Coast Drilling, Vanguard Construction for the concrete barrier, Striking Graphics, and Mike Brown Electric. Great subcontractor group with Gelati Construction. So here's some of the night work. We have new drainage across that segment of roadway. That helps the maintainability and the climate resiliency. You see some of the night paving. Here's the wall with the sheet piles over here in the right photo on the eastbound shoulder with the bay in the distance. So that'll help protect, as well as raising the profile 2 feet, also help protect that part of the roadway versus higher flows. You can see some of the other work just repairing levees next to Novato Creek within the state right-of-way. And on the right photo, we backfill between the concrete barriers, the sheet piles. Sheet piles go down 20 feet That provides stopping flow from going under the roadway and dealing with the bay-like sediment. We have some work, and we thank you for your patience during those 9 days. We have some work through the summer, and here's just a short list: some temporary closures, some pipehead walls and flap gates, some minor paving work, and erosion control. So excellent work by the contractor group, the Caltrans staff, and all the resource agencies that are currently following up with us. It's been terrific. We want to thank all of you for your patience and support through this emergency contract. Thanks.
And who said Caltrans can't respond to an emergency? Absolutely, and we thank them for the work that they did in reopening the roadway. For the first part of the flood, they actually eased the flooding by pumping water from one side of 37 to the other side. And then they discovered the tides were coming in so fast that pumping no longer worked. So indeed, we really appreciate Caltrans' responsiveness. And I think in your questions, you can probably ask us, what's the future of Caltrans' involvement on Highway 37? It's my pleasure now to introduce my colleague, Supervisor David Rabbit. The very first year that I became a supervisor, all of the supervisors from the four counties came together. We didn't have brisk discussions, but the one thing that we did agree on is that Highway 37 was problematic for all of us. And from that arose the four county policy committee, and David was elected to chair that. So thank you so much for being here tonight.
And thank you very much. And I really, good evening, everyone. And again, thank you, Susan, for allowing me to be here. I just want to say real quickly that Susan, I want to congratulate her for being appointed to the San Francisco Bay Restoration Authority just last week or so, a couple weeks ago. That was that AA for the Bay measure that was passed by the nine counties, $12 parcel tax that will generate, what, $25 million a year to be used for building resiliency around the Bay. And you can think of no better projects than here in the North Bay, and including some of the work on Highway 37, because we have an expensive endeavor in front of us. Real quickly on the, I think it was about 3 years ago when we first started talking about dealing with Highway 37 because of the inundation, the traffic nightmare at the typically calls the Sonoma Raceway 121, where it pinches down from the four lanes to two. I think the radio and television traffic doesn't even mention that anymore, because that's just a given that it's going to be backed up for miles at that location. But it's really unacceptable going forward. We thought we had a congestion problem on the eastern side of the road, and not much of a problem on the western side until this year, when it was closed for those 27 days. So obviously we have a flooding problem, and because of the low elevation of the road on the west, and we still have that both problems on the east to deal with. So the four counties did get together and try to figure out what can we do about this. And I think it was also hampered, and you should know this, that this is every county's second priority, and that makes it difficult because it's an expensive endeavor. Well, Marin County's priority is to deal with 580. We wish it was 101, but it's 580. Sonoma County still needs to complete 101. We have that section through Petaluma and certainly in the Narrows of Marin. Napa County's priority is Highway 29. And Solano County's priority is really Highway 80. And so it makes it very difficult to go after such a large, it's almost a 21-mile piece of roadway here through really the three counties, although it affects Napa going forward.
I don't mean to interrupt, but this is a connector to every single one of the highways you mentioned.
I totally get it. I think it goes to show you that the needs are always greater than the resources. And I know that Mr. McKenzie will come up here and tell us all about the resources that he's going to provide us. So looking forward to that. But it is true. Obviously a very, very important road, I think, for all of us. The number of cars that travel it each and every day, the trucks that travel it each and every day as well. I think, especially for Sonoma County, quite frankly, that's the main east-west connection for the truckers. We certainly don't want them necessarily on other roads coming over through Freitas or over that way through Petaluma. So we really do want to keep them down there. We want to make sure that we have a resilient roadway going forward. Dan mentioned the fact that the roadway is also dropped, so we have gravity and climate change working against us, because the road is actually going down at least a foot or two, or maybe even 30 inches. Meanwhile, the bay level rise is coming up. And even in the best of days at high tide, sometimes on the eastern half, you'd be driving along Highway 37 and the water would be licking at the pretty much the fog line of the roadway. Obviously something that we need to really tackle and deal with. A very, very preliminary back of the envelope estimate to deal with the one point or the nearly 21 mile segment was anywhere from $1.4 to $4.2 billion. That's a lot of money. And it's a lot of money when it's your, quite frankly, the second priority, and you have all these other things that you're trying to achieve. So the four counties could get together and look for a long-range plan. We were approached by a private entity that was willing to build a section of the roadway and put a toll on it. And quite frankly, whatever comes out of the four counties, it may very well be a toll, because that might be the source of dollars that are out there that are available. I think Dan did mention it, but I think if you go through the regular Caltrans route as we know it today, we can complete the freeway that way, but it would be 2088. And it would probably be about 3 feet underwater or so by then. So we need to look for an alternative way to get the roadway going forward. There are significant local impacts, and that's why, again, I think the four counties are at the table because of the commerce, because of the freight. We have embarked, through the help of MTC, and the president of MTC here tonight will tell us this as well, with a corridor study. They're kind of that first step you take in terms of trying to figure out how you go forward on a transportation corridor. It's about an $800,000 study. I think the natural progression from that would go into an environmental document and as a feasibility and work your way down into the construction piece going forward. Certainly this year's 27 days of closure is unacceptable. And hats off again to Jelati Construction and everyone for making the quick fix. Adding all that weight to the roadway is also, we hope, doesn't exasperate the gravity going forward. It's not there's not a lot of solid ground beneath the roadway. But again, transportation dollars are very difficult to come by. And tomorrow, Sacramento, I know that Suzanne Smith was up in Sacramento today doing some good lobbying. SB1 is going to be voted on, I believe, by the Senate and the Assembly soon thereafter. $52 billion measure that over 10 years that for statewide here in Sonoma County will actually fare quite well. And as you know, or I hope you know, we have been trying to fix our local roads, and this will be very beneficial. Could double what we get in the gas tax here locally, which has been a problem because we have an awful lot of roads in Sonoma County. We have 1,384.6 miles. We have one of the most highly parcelized counties around. However, we developed in the olden days, it's just a very parcelized, lots of roads, which means lots of maintenance. And the sad fact is that the gas tax formulas do not benefit our county, because I can tell you, out of every dollar, 56% stays with the state and takes care of the state roads. 44% gets split evenly among cities and counties. The cities just take their money on a per capita basis, just strictly population. And on the county side, it's based on a formula that is 75% on your population, 25% on your road miles. And here in Sonoma County, a county of 500,000 people with 1,384.6 miles of roads, we don't fare as well. Napa County, for instance, has 420 miles of roads to take care of. That's Marin. Napa is 460. Solano is 601. And again, we have more than twice as many here in Sonoma. So that's kind of why the roads are the way they are. But we have put $65 million in general fund dollars into the roads. We've paved through this paving cycle nearly 300 miles of roads. So if you were living in Napa County, you would have 3/4 of your roads already paved, brand new, within the last 3 years. But here in Sonoma County, because of the amount of roads we have, it's harder to see. But we are making that push going forward. And I will just mention lastly, as chair of the Sonoma County Transportation Authority as well, that Measure M, which is really your self-help local transportation measure, which I've got to tell you is so important to have as a county in California, because it's the only way that you can match dollars that come down from the state that you can really leverage. And we've done a great job in terms of leveraging the dollars on the freeway projects, for instance, 5, 6, 7 to 1. that we need to maintain that going forward. We are one of the only counties with a quarter cent sales tax measure. Most other counties have a half cent or more. LA County has a penny and a half, and we have a quarter cent. And truly, had we had a half the last time we went to the ballot, we would have had a complete freeway. By now, we could have used that money elsewhere, and our roads undoubtedly would be in better shape. But we're working on that. That measure does expire in April of 2025, looking to go on the ballot in November of 2018. And still, although the idea it would be to extend the quarter and add a quarter, ideally, because that could give us $1.17 billion for local roads in Sonoma County. And I think that actually would be a generational change about the way our roads are maintained. And you would see that, I think, pretty darn quickly going forward. So keep that in the back of your mind, although we haven't necessarily, it kind of depends on what happens with the state and whether or not that state, those state dollars really make a difference. I can tell you through Susan Clausen, our Transportation Public Works Director, that we have to backfill the maintenance to the tune of about $3.5 million or $3.8 million in about 18 positions because the gas tax formulas don't help us. And obviously with the road conditions the way they were, especially this this winter with all the potholes, we want to make sure that we prop that up, but we're not getting the funds there. Most people don't realize that roads are really a user fee type of charge to take care of them. People think they pay their property taxes. Why is my road in the condition it is? It's really based upon the gas tax, always has been, at least since Prop 13. And that's kind of the piece on that. So I almost sidetracked on the road piece. But Suzanne Smith is here from the Executive Director of Sonoma County Transportation, who will take us through the nitty gritty of what we're trying to do on the Highway 37, which is really the counties of Marin, Sonoma, Napa, and Solano.
Good evening. So I'm the technical portion, which is somewhat daunting given how vast this corridor is, but I want to go through a little bit of detail on what's going to happen over the year 2017 in terms of advancing the project. So we've talked a bit about the corridor itself. From the implementer side, we've looked at this in three segments, A, B, and C, working from west to east. So Sonoma County specifically is involved with, you know, up in terms of our right-of-way, it's related to segments A and B, but we are working closely, as you've heard, with the other three counties in the North Bay. My chairman, Mr. Rabbit, mentioned that the Metropolitan Transportation Commission has partnered with us and with Caltrans and helped fund what's called a design alternative analysis. When you look at this corridor, it's been out there a good long time. As Dan mentioned, it's starting to, it has subsided over the years. It's on bay mud. And there aren't a lot of good data points around what's the existing condition, what are design alternatives we should be looking at. I mean, we can talk conceptually, right? We need additional lanes to deal with congestion. We need to elevate it due to sea level rise. But looking at it in greater detail about what we actually need to do at specific points along the corridor is something that has not been done. So working with MTC and Caltrans, the four counties are going to do what's called a design alternative analysis. And the approach to this effort is to look at existing data and policies around sea level rise and the best practices in assessing sea level rise. You've heard some about that tonight. There's some good science out there. It is speculative, right? I mean, we don't know precisely how to address or what we're going to see with sea level rise and climate change, but we're using the best data available and the best science available. And then we're gonna look at an understanding what to expect around sea level rise, also understanding the timing. And it's critical to look at permanent inundation versus flooding events. They may be happening at the same time on occasion, but looking at the long view and what to do with this corridor for another 100 years, we need to look at aspects that deal with where is sea level creeping up and ultimately going to impact the corridor versus what locations are in peril during storm events right now, as we saw earlier this year. So that's on the sea level rise side. We've got, you know, we've got an approach that will use the best data and best science and analysis we can put forward. And then we've got the traffic forecast and the operational analysis that will be the other component of the study. And this is the part where we're actually much better at it because we've been doing this a long time. We've been doing traffic forecasting. We have very detailed travel demand models that explain behaviors of what happens when you make changes in a transportation corridor. We'll be looking at the near term as well as further out into 2040. And that's the slide for that that I just said. Sorry about that. So in terms of the solutions for flooding and sea level rise, Dan spoke to some of the work that's been done given this most recent event. So drainage improvements, shoreline improvements, that's what we saw with the bay wall that Caltrans installed and the upgrades that they're doing with some of the drainage out there. The longer term solutions, the more you go out, you see the need for more significant levee improvements. It gets challenging because they're not all public levees. In fact, a good number of them are privately owned levees. And the jurisdiction and costs and authority to do things with those levees or require people to do things with those levees is challenging. And something that, you know, integrates into this in different ways depending on who you're dealing with. And then ultimately, in the long-term solution, you see restoration of wetlands and improving the corridor by elevating it out of risk from sea level rise, and in that same way addressing the capacity issues by creating that second lane in each direction in segment B, where it's currently one lane in each direction. We'll also be looking at natural resources and restoration there. So we'll be looking at natural adaptation solutions, and this is to look more towards the impacts. Well, it'll address flooding as well, but also address the sea level rise inundation that happens over time. If you have open lands that can absorb the impacts of that with better marshlands or more extensive marshlands and baylands, that can help deal with the impacts of sea level rise and also with mitigating for storms. So you have smaller scale wetland restoration projects with minor habitat improvements, and then you scale that up over time depending on resources, and the nexus between transportation projects and resource and habitat projects is one that we're sussing out and trying to figure out who goes first and how you make those decisions in partnership. But then looking at the manner in which you do levee improvements so that they have a more mild and natural slope, that's beneficial for habitat because of the ability to have marshlands and not just a berm and the bay. And then again, once you get to the point of elevating the roadway on a causeway, working on the hydrological activity that connects the bay into the marshlands and how that functions most beneficially and protects the species as well that are out there. So the design alternative analysis approach is going to be done in two phases. Phase one is the corridor plan. And again, this is a 21-mile corridor. So there are a lot of points on this corridor with very specific needs, not just the concept of we need to address flooding or congestion conceptually. We need to start looking at specific points along the corridor. So first step is the data collection and assessment analysis. And then the second part of this phase is developing a corridor plan. So this will be a high level framework that looks at our constraints, our vulnerabilities, you know, at specific locations, what risks do we have? We'll look at a no build assessment. What if we don't do anything? I mean, you saw earlier the sea level rise slides, right? So we have a general idea, but let's lay that out and talk about what the impacts are. What are some of the economic impacts, the tourism impacts, the commute impacts? So let's, you know, what is that no build assessment? And then take some time to talk about how you might want to phase improvements. What makes sense to go first? What maybe, you know, what's a rational approach from a congestion perspective and a sea level rise perspective? And then identify the priority segments. We've done projects like this before in that we've tackled big projects in the North Bay. We mentioned earlier, Chairman Rabbit mentioned the Highway 101 corridor. Over $1 billion in that have been spent in the Highway 101 corridor in Sonoma County, or will be when we finish the Narrows. And you don't get a check for $1 billion from somebody and then go build it. You piece together the funds from multiple sources over time and do it in phases. And so I think that is an example of how I think that's similar to how we'll be approaching Highway 37. What are the priority segments, and what can we afford to do when and how? So once we get that priority segment identified and target some of the tasks that need to occur there, we will move on to phase two. So assuming, and this is an assumption at this point, but let's say segment B is the priority segment. So that's the middle part that has the congestion issues. That's not the right slide. I want to point to this because what's relevant about this, why I put this in here, is if we lose 37, which is possible under the no build assessment, this is the detour. And you all live out in the valley, you know what these roads are like. If you're relying on 116, 121 to carry that 41,000 additional cars a day, we're big trouble. And it's no better if you take the southern route with 580. Both of those are impacted routes, and they're not built for that added level of traffic. So it just points to the need for maintaining this corridor. It is a regional route of significance, or emergency route, sorry, or under the Caltrans rubric. You're dying to say something.
I just want to say those routes are already being used to a significant extent to make up for the serious developmental holdback that 37 has had. Even if, I'm sorry, I was going to hold this until the question answered here, but I just got to say.
We know.
Yeah, even if climate change was not an issue
understand.
At all, this meeting is like 10 years overdue.
I hear you. So the phase two development we'll look at, let's say segment B, that's a funny challenge that we talked about that. We'll look at something like, what if we only add capacity and in a shorter term, and we add one lane with a movable barrier? You've driven on the Golden Gate Bridge, they move the barrier based on, because it's a very commute-driven traffic issue out on 37 now. Is that something that can be done first? Is that more affordable? And, so we'll explore that, for example. Explore a four-lane segment. How are we going to fund these improvements? Tolling is a very real aspect that we're going to have to consider. And there's a question about, do you consider it like a toll bridge or do you consider it a toll road? How do you toll all of the lanes? Do you toll one way? Do you get, those are things that need to be explored. I will say the last year or so, we've worked with a financial advisor who specializes in tolling projects, and they've provided some good data. PFAL, Public Finance Alternatives, anyway, PFAL, they are, a lot of the resources that they've provided to us are available at the SCTA website, which I'll put up here at the end. But we've spent about a year working with them on what it would mean to potentially toll this corridor. So that will work, will inform this discussion about design alternatives. We're going to look at improving travel modes. So not if you put the new lane out there, that's great. But what about how do we deal with commuter parking, express buses, potentially shoulder running with buses? What sort of bike facilities are out there? How do you extend the Bay Trail to provide some continuity for alternative modes? And then looking at some specific intersections or an interchange. So 121 and Lakeville. Even if you widen it and you have traffic signals, that's far less functional. So looking at what we need to do at those intersections. And then what sort of operational or technological items could, that are less expensive than the large capital projects, what about ramp metering at Mare Island where it narrows down from two lanes to one? Is there value in managing that so that it flows better, more evenly? And then we will conduct a detailed analysis of all of those things, looking at the operations, the design, the costs, environmental screening. Showed you that. And this is the schedule. So we aspire to, the consultant is on board. Kimley Horn is the traffic consultant, and AECOM is the sea level rise consultant. And they've done a good, AECOM in particular has done a large amount of the work that's been conducted to date in the corridor on sea level rise. And Kimley Horn is their traffic experts. That is their wheelhouse. So we're very pleased that they are the team we'll be working with. We'll get through phase one by the middle to end of this summer and then start up with phase two. There are definitely opportunities for public engagement. There are the routine policy committee meetings that are public meetings of the four counties that Chairman Rabbit mentioned. And then also we will be planning some workshops in the local jurisdictions that are impacted by the corridor, as well as some other outreach tools that we're working on. And then, you know, I am happy to speak to groups that are interested. So always welcome the opportunity to be invited to share what we're up to in the corridor. And with that, I will turn it back to Director Moore. Thank you.
Thanks. Now I'd like to introduce, and please be patient, save your questions. We will have opportunity for questions after the fact. I want to acknowledge the presence, I believe, our Mayor Rachel Hunley from the City of Sonoma. There you are at the back of the room getting a little coffee or water. And thank you, Rebecca Garcia, representing Congressman Mike Thompson. We appreciate you both being here tonight. And now it's my pleasure to introduce my great friend and colleague. And we are so lucky to have the chair, president, what are you, of the Metropolitan Transportation Commission. He's going to tell you all about it, and he's going to promise us billions of dollars for the MTC to fund this project. Darn, what are you?
Well, that's a good question, and many people have asked that. Yes, I am Jake McKenzie. I do have some relevance in this discussion. First of all, I'm a veteran of over 20 years of the debate about transportation issues in Sonoma County and the North Bay. And over the last 8 years as Sonoma County's representative on the Metropolitan Transportation Commission, it's been my job to represent the cities and the county of Sonoma as we debate where federal and state monies are allocated in the nine Bay Area counties. Now, when I always get this. Well, now you're chair of MTC, Jake. You'll be bringing all this money back to Sonoma County, won't you? And my answer to that is no, I won't be bringing all that money back to Sonoma County. But I'll be fighting for our share as I have for the last 8 years. And the only good thing, well, not the only good thing, there's many good things about being the chair of MTC. It's great for my ego. People return my phone calls. And that's the important thing, return the phone call. Yes, that's Jake McKenzie on the phone. And so I do get the ear of people a wee bit more readily than when I was a mere commissioner. It got a wee bit better when I was the vice chair for 2 years, but now I'm the chair, so they all return my phone calls. But what are they returning phone calls about? Recognize that the four North Bay counties described by the chair of our policy working group recognize that our population is a wee bit over 1 million. The four counties, Solano, Napa, Sonoma, Marin. That leaves five counties, City and County of San Francisco, Contra Costa, Alameda, San Mateo, Santa Clara. Well, if we're just over 1 million, that means there's over 6 million in those five counties. And by policy, we have, over the last decade, through Plan Bay Area and other activities, we have directed the monies, a large share of the monies, towards that triangle that you can think of in your head as San Francisco, Oakland, San Jose, as the area where the jobs are, where we would like to see more of the housing located, and where we want to make sure that our transportation systems are working most efficiently. So by definition, more of these monies have been going to that five county area. We in the four north counties have to fight for our monies. So I don't want there to be any false impressions about this. And when there are allocations, hopefully the state transportation legislation will pass. Hopefully there will be these allocations of dollars that you've heard about. But when it comes to capital and big capital investments, set aside the improving the roads and solving the pothole problem, the big capital programs are going to be competitive. And that's exactly what it means. We will have a competitive project in Highway 37. Competitive to the sense that we're going to have to fight our corner to make sure that as we advance through the stages described here, this next year is just the beginning of this battle, believe me. It's just the beginning. And again, I'll go back to previous remarks made. We have priorities long established in these four counties, and I'll mention them again because it's very real. My colleague Jim Spearing in Solano County fights his corner for the Cordelia Junction 680 expenditures, and to date he's been very successful. David Rabbit, myself, Suzanne, those of us from Marin who deal with the 101 Marin-Sonoma Narrows problem, I've been fighting that fight along with them for the last 20 years, and we still don't have the funding to complete that project. How many are we short, Suzanne Smith?
We're short $85 million in Sonoma County and $120
million
in Marin County.
Okay.
Can we pass a hat?
Go to Marin County. What exercises them? They don't get quite as exercised for some weird Marin reason about the 101 Sonoma Marin Narrows, but they get really exercised about the 580 Richmond San Rafael, the 580 101 complex and the problems that are there. And Napa Highway 29, I think you probably are all aware of those problems. These are already identified. So I'm not going to spend a lot of time talking about the technical details of what we're doing with the money we so prudently supplied through MTC to make sure that we are doing these design alternatives. But the comment that I got talking to our senior staff was, this is the first serious engineering work that has been done on the 37 corridor. This has not been a priority. It has existed. It has slowly been attacked by the rising sea level. And I'm surprised that somebody didn't say this, but if you get the UC Davis dude in front of you, he'll tell you that he has been personally, as an investigator, surprised by the rapidity with which the erosion of the levees next to 37, where Tole Creek and that Tole, I don't know, they call it Tole Lake or whatever the hell it is to the south of 37, but you can see the erosion there. It is, and with those high tides, it has been proceeding at a more rapid rate than he had anticipated. So this is very real, and of course the true reality you've heard about from Dan and the great work that was done. So let me just say, there's important events taking place, obviously in the state legislature. With the passage of that legislation, then we'll have a chance to compete for future dollars. Number two, Regional Measure 3.
This has not yet been mentioned tonight, but Regional Measure 3 is the daughter of Regional Measure 2, which was the daughter of Regional Measure 1. And you may well ask, well, what's Regional Measure 3? Toll money from the toll bridges. And that's something I learned when I joined MTC 8 years ago. Not only was I on the Metropolitan Transportation Commission, I became a member of the Bay Area Toll Authority. Now, you think you're dealing with big bucks when you're dealing with MTC monies, but the real money comes in from the tolls into the Bay Area Toll Authority, and it is, we are charged in BATA with maintaining the integrity of the bridges, hence the new East Bay span from Yerba Buena Island over to Oakland. And all of the seismic retrofitting that has gone on over the past number of years. RM1 and RM2 allocated monies from these tolls being collected to other projects to alleviate traffic congestion problems in 7 Bay Area counties, not 9. Sonoma County did not vote in the last 2 measures because we were not adjudged to have that nexus between an actual bridge connecting to us and our residents, you all. But I'll bet you there's most of you in this room are paying bridge tolls as part of your lives. And I know I am as a resident of Runner Park as I go about my business. So RM3 will include all 9 counties as we work with the legislature once they get their immediate task performed. We are planning to work with the legislature to look at toll increases to provide, frankly, to provide more money and potentially again to help with a project like the Highway 37 project. And the last thing I'll say before I be quiet here is, remember the history of 37. 1928 was a toll road, 35 cents. And I have a wee ticket that says, toll road, 35 cents, paid. State bought it in 1938, and it became a state highway. Well, when you start talking about actually doing something, particularly in Phase B, between the 120-137 and the Mare Island Bridge, you're talking about tolls. And if you're talking to the United Bridge Partners, sure, they're happy to build a large elevated highway, and they are happy as a for-profit entity to look at the potential for money coming into their coffers over the decades to come. Well, it happens that we in BATA are also in the business, as I've just said, of collecting tolls. And our view, and this is a policy thing that we will have more debates on, obviously, but it's certainly our feeling in MTC and BATA, and I'm kind of agreeing with this approach that we, as MTC BATA, working with the 4 counties, should be in, if you will excuse this very weak pun, in the driver's seat as we move forward. We could see the potential for a public-private partnership where we could share, we would be sharing some of the risk as a public entity, but we would not be operating as a for-profit entity. And so I will tell you, it's no secret, Jim Spearing from Solano County would want us to be going hell for leather with United Bridge Partners right away. And he makes no secret of that. These are public meetings. This has been discussed. And we have a somewhat different view. This will come out over the next 12 months. We're on a fast track with this project. And so I don't know if there's any other great wise remarks I wanted to share with you or not. Probably not. I think that's, you've heard enough from me. I'll answer questions if I can, and if I can't, I'll ask Suzanne Smith to answer them. Thank you.
David and I were joking when I invited Jake. He said, Jake, brief, is that really going to happen? Well,
was that brief?
That was pretty close.
Yeah,
you heard the bell.
Getting better.
So it was all good. But you provided a lot of the remarks that I was going to provide regarding the fact that Highway 37 started out as a toll road.
You had your chance at the beginning.
I did. I did. I knew that one. Well, Jake often eclipses. eclipses me, but that's okay. About two or three years ago, a private entity, a team, came, took Sonoma County by storm. They came up with a solution. They recognized that we have a significant congestion problem. They made presentations to many business groups and other folks about the proposal that Jake sort of introduced. And this is the team called United Bridge Partners. Andy Kendall and Linda Figg are here to give you an abbreviated version of the presentation that they've been showing around the Bay Area. And yeah, so Jake already sort of soured your message, but that's okay. Okay.
They'll recover just fine.
Yes, they will. I think they may have heard this before. And Linda, thank you so much for being here. And let us know. Let us hear what your proposal is.
Thank you very much. So my name's Ed Diffendall, and my partner, Linda Figg. We're with United Bridge Partners. We've been at this problem and looking at this quarter for a number of years. As has been already discussed, we've made a proposal here. What I'd like to do is just spend a very brief period of time telling you about the proposal, a little bit about who we are, and what our solution is for the B section. And we're talking about the section between Sears Point and Crown Isle. And then we'll obviously be happy to answer any questions. So our company, United Bridge Partners, is a partnership between a financial investment fund called the American Infrastructure Fund, which I'll tell you about a little bit more about in a second, and Linda's company, Figg Engineering Group, which is an engineering and construction firm. Collectively, we develop, design, own, operate private toll bridges. We have two projects in Virginia and one in Indiana that we own and operate today, and a number of others. So our vision and our mission as a company is to design bridge, to design, own, and operate private assets in a private-public partnership sort of format. We typically, though, are different from some of the other proposals that you might have seen in that we don't use any local, state, or federal money. We have $1 billion commitment from our investors, which provides the capital required to fund the construction and operation of these projects. And by necessity, we typically will look to charge a modest toll collected in an open road toll or an all-electronic tolling format, similar to the Golden Gate Bridge. We would envision using fast track in this project, which we'll tell you a little bit more about. We created in 2010. Our first project was in Virginia, which we built in under 2 years, and we've been operating, called the South Norfolk Jordan Bridge, and very successfully operating since 2012. The financial commitment comes from the American Infrastructure Fund, based in here in the Bay Area. We manage about $2.5 billion in capital, based down in Foster City. So quite a ways from the State Route 37 corridor, but I personally, from San Francisco, as I've spent a lot of time stuck in traffic listening to my three-year-old scream in the back seat. So this is a project I'm very passionate about, and I've experienced a lot of the pain that I'm sure you all have from congestion. We have about 22 people working down in Foster City and have investments all across the infrastructure of real property, natural resources sectors, and transportation infrastructure is one that we're very, very passionate about, as you see from our financial commitment. So Linda's going to tell you a little bit about her organization and our proposal, and then we'll wrap up with some of the benefits.
Great. It's a pleasure to be here and share with you this proposal, which we can accomplish very quickly and is ready to go if you're interested in this idea. So our company, my company is, our slogan is Creating Bridges as Art, which is the technology, the environmental preservation, and the aesthetics of bridges. A little bit of background, we've been accomplishing this for 39 years throughout the country and some foreign countries with 366 awards for bridges. You may recognize some of these. This is the I-70 in Colorado. This is a bridge, our private bridge, in Virginia called the South Norfolk Jordan Bridge that we created with United Bridge Partners together. This is a bridge that is near Arches National Park, where we're preserving the environment and accomplishing a bridge across the Colorado River. Our customers have three presidential awards through the National Endowment for the Arts. There's only five of these awards ever been given by the President of the United States, and our company has three of those. They include some bridges that maybe you have crossed over before. Two for the National Park Service, the Blue Ridge Parkway Viaduct in North Carolina, and the Natchez Trace Parkway Arches just south of Nashville, Tennessee. So when it comes to solutions that need to be high and meet sea level rise and accomplish important crossings like over railroads or making improvements at intersections, whatever that solution is that a bridge can accomplish, this is what our expertise is. So when we look at the Bay Area transportation map, we can see through the colors, these numbers represent the number of lanes that exist. And so you have 8 lanes and 6 lanes, and as you come on to State Road 37, you have 4 on one side, another 4 on the other side, and then the bottleneck of 2 in the middle. This really impedes flow and has a big impact on the overall transportation network. So our proposal is to enhance the capacity of this section. And really, it's a 9-mile expansion, including a new interchange for more free-flowing traffic at 121, and also on Mare Island. So you see this dashed line here. This would represent a new 2-lane, which would be a bridge for a large portion of it, and then also elevated roadway. This is all based on what the environmental permitting will determine, as will be the most benefit for the circulation of the environmental aspects of the area. So we've just kind of dashed it in symbolically right now. So this would be 2 lanes going eastbound, and then we would convert the existing 2 lanes to westbound. And then that way we can then get that opened very, very quickly so that that traffic can be accomplished better. And then following that, in a future stage, we would replace what is existing there now as the current 2-lane. So our commitment to success. We made a proposal to the State Road 37 Committee, which we're going to summarize here tonight, last year. And before that, we studied this whole thing, this whole alignment and everything, for about 3 years. Taking a look at what could be accomplished, talking to environmental agencies, environmental interests. We talked to the unions, we talked to everyone to see how we could accomplish this in the very best way. So through that discussion, on May 5th of last year, we submitted our proposal, a formal document to the policy committee, and provided some answers to questions so that we could be sure that we were addressing all of the needs. And so we're ready to fund all the next steps and studies, environmental, legal, with no local, state, or federal money. Our mission as United Bridge Partners is to rebuild infrastructure throughout America. That's our goal. We know there's not enough local, state, and federal money through the country, and we have huge infrastructure needs everywhere. So we're trying to tackle that problem in a very special way. It's a unique approach. It's something that we've been pioneering across the country. So we're also efficiently would use this information for the adjacent segments so that we would to fund those kinds of studies on those areas as well. So our proposal is basically summarized here. To design, build, finance, and own and operate a 2-lane expansion, which would be increasing it to 4 lanes, construction completed in 30 months, built using all local labor and local materials, replacing the existing 2 lanes at a time when the elevated structure needs to be there to combat the sea level rises. Use only private American funding, no local, state, or federal money. So there's no financial risks at all to the counties or the state of California. So significant advantages to the environment, built with environmentally sensitive construction techniques. A portion of every paid toll will be contributed to an environmental fund to support restoration and other environmental programs in San Pablo Bay. Some of the problems with not being able to do these important environmental initiatives is that there is not enough money to even get the matching funds from the federal government. This will provide the opportunity to address many of the important needs, whether there are water resource issues or flooding or whatever it might be. Provides advantages to the community. Crossing for emergency vehicles would, of course, be at no charge. Subsidized van pools and transponders for low-income residents. User-friendly electronic tolling using your standard fast track. And we'll accomplish it using existing legal processes. We already know what the process would need to be in order to accomplish this quickly. So our commitment to the long-term facility success is in two phases. Phase one is to build the two lanes next to and south of the existing facility as quickly as possible and relieve that traffic congestion. Include dedicated bicycle paths with scenic views, adjust existing two lanes for the environmental enhancements with berms and like culverts or other things, responsible for the existing lanes maintenance. So we would take over those existing lanes and take care of all the maintenance and operation of those. We would be fully responsible for that access and the viability of those. We will also study the possibility of three lanes with a reversible lane as part of the new facility so that there are options, so that you have Plan B available as well. These circles represent the interchange areas that would be improved with the project. So this animation here shows the kind of technique that we would use to build over the wetland areas. We don't have to use any equipment on the ground. We actually install piling out in front. You can see here, it just happened. Then we leapfrog a platform. Behind here, you'll see precast segments coming forward. So there's no equipment on the ground. It's all built from the top. This is a system that we have pioneered in America to preserve the environment and to do things quickly using local resources. So traffic would continue to flow on State Road 37 throughout the construction period. So here you'll see the precast pieces. And of course, everything would be accomplished in accordance with seismic criteria, because we know how important that is and we have all of that latest technology.
So I think we heard the hook, so we'll just real quickly summarize some of the other benefits. Look, one of the things that we'll be able to provide here with this new structure would be the opportunity for pedestrian and bicycle transit, which is something that's desperately needed in this corridor. Would we be using eco-friendly concrete with a 100 to 150 year design life here. So it's obviously very important to design for the very long term. The sea level rise, and this is something that this structure would enable. And we'd fix the intersections, which is really, really important as part of the overall project. We are committed to the long term here. And I like to think of this project as having both a short-term problem and a long-term problem. The short-term problem is congestion. And all the traffic that we all experience, 40,000 vehicles a day, they're stuck in traffic every single day out there. There is a long-term sea level rise problem with the existing corridor. And so our plan is to install the new two-lane section immediately, operate both sections as Linda described, and then fund the replacement of the existing section with a similar raised structure, which would solve the problem of sea level rise for the B segment. And so this solves both your short-term congestion problem and your long-term sea level rise problem on that B segment. It's really, really important that we solve both of those. And as part of this overall program, we're making deposits into an account that would be dedicated to maintenance and to growth of the project for maintenance and inspection, so there's no question that it would continue to operate. So this is something that we're doing today in Virginia, that we're constructing today in Indiana, and that we can achieve very quickly here in California to solve a problem that exists today. We're committed also to solving a number of other problems as we presented to the State Route Policy Committee. There have been other issues which have been raised, which are very, very important to the community, including how do you solve a problem for low-income residents in installing a new toll. So one of the things that we've talked about is subsidizing and running a van pool. There's no public transit, as you know, in this corridor today. So this would be a subsidized program that would enable lower-income residents to move in the corridor and avoid the toll, as well as providing subsidized transponders. That's a program that's very difficult to administer, but that we're committed to making work. Obviously, there's discounts for Fast Track, as there is in other situations, and commuter club programs and other sorts of seasonal things that we would do as an operator of the facility. Many people have been asked, well, what's the toll going to do? And what we're committed and what we can make the project work is a toll that's similar to and will never be higher than what other people are paying, what you're paying on other facilities today. Okay, so what you pay on the Bay Bridge one way is what you'll pay on the State Route 37. That's the order of magnitude that would be required to support a project of this order of magnitude. And that's just the economic reality, whether it's a bad MTC sort of program, a private program, a P3 program, or a publicly funded revenue. There are lots of benefits to the environment. One of the key ones here, though, is that we are making a commitment to provide a portion of every paid toll to an environmental fund that we're not involved in administering. The Bay Institute has been a big part of our team developing this program, and organizations like the Bay Institute and others would administer the program, would provide funds to remediate the San Pablo Bay. And we're committed to preparing all the materials necessary, to utilizing Fast Track, and to taking on all the risks associated with this project. We'll take construction risk, traffic revenue risk, design risk, operating risk. You know, this is something we can achieve very quickly, and that our company is very prepared to do and has a lot of experience in doing. And there's been a lot of community support. You know, as we've talked about, we've been at this for 3 years, talking with business, environmental groups, lots of other folks, other public meetings like this one. And there's a lot of support because there's so much pain out there in the courtroom right now. And we've got a lot of endorsement letters here from many organizations. And so we'd love to hear your feedback and continue to revise. And I think that's it.
I want to thank all of our panelists for spending time with us tonight. A lot of great information. But now it's your turn to ask the question. Well, first of all, could you help me thank the many people here who are here? And just a preface, whether the Highway 37 is privatized for a toll road with United Bridge Partners, or whether we work through a financing mechanism with BATA, the Bay Area Tolling Authority, each of those requires state legislation. And I think it goes without saying that our legislators probably won't carry legislation until we all agree on the, well, we will never all agree on how we move forward, but we would have to have substantial agreement. So thank you again, I really appreciate that. And if you could line up behind this microphone and please try to limit your comments to very brief comments, question, otherwise you will get the hook. And please identify yourself, thank you.
My name is Larry Leonard, and I'm a local Sonoma resident. And my question is for the United Bridge Project, which, by the way, I want to thank you. That seemed like a very well thought out presentation, as short as it was. So if, by some miracle, Donald Trump's infrastructure projects get approved, and how would that benefit us? Because my understanding is that that is geared toward like an 82-cent type of tax credit for the contractor, and the contractor has the option of the toll road. So would the county benefit from that, or would that strictly be money in your pocket?
Thank you. And each of the, we're going to share the microphones here at the table. I appreciate your question. The question was, how does this fare under Trump's proposed infrastructure initiative?
So we don't know all the details of the Trump. Pardon?
You're not the only.
Yeah. So, but what we can say is certainly we want to take advantage of any possibility that would help us to lower the cost of the project and to provide the very lowest toll that we possibly can. Our goal is to have users and to make this a user-friendly system. This is a very long-term investment with very patient money. So our goal is to have a very small toll as much as we can and be able to accomplish it very quickly so that it's open as fast as possible.
And go ahead, and Suzanne, perhaps you could address the question, the proposed infrastructure of our president, package of our president, will that benefit us?
Yeah, the other way that I want to point out is integral to the plan, what little we know about it, if you watched the press conference yesterday, was the time it takes to work through a public process. And there was the chart that one of the guys held up that was literally like head to toe of steps in time. To the extent that that's streamlined and enables us to achieve the project more quickly, we would want to take a benefit of that.
I, appreciate your comment that no one knows the details of the federal proposal because there really actually hasn't been a federal proposal that we can look at and understand. I wouldn't hold my breath. So if there is a federal proposal, we will fight like hell to get what we can from Sonoma County, whatever approach that will require. But we can't. I can't tell you how we're going to do it, given we don't know what the proposal will be.
Thanks, Dan. From the perspective of Caltrans, how would that proposal affect the state at large?
Well, I think Chair McKenzie said it right. Today, tomorrow, the next few days in the state legislature really the most important to us right now. I think they all agree that what happens on the East Coast is going to take many moons to iron out. But we're very, very close at the state level to consensus. And let's hope they get the votes tomorrow or the next day.
Thanks. And your question?
I have a very quick one. Nancy Ramsey, I'm a resident here in Sonoma. And I wonder if we could do two simple things to quickly move the traffic along as it exists without any construction. One would be to have the California police stay at the intersection. I bet it would take only a few days to ticket the people who come up in the left way and then I bet you one day, and then a week later, one day, and then a week later, one day, and it won't be long before that stops. And secondly, Steve, if you could re-barricade the speedway.
Yes.
That would be a great help, because we can't even get out of Sonoma on some days, because folks have gone to the speedway, turned around, and blocked all the lanes. So we have to do an illegal passage on the right lane. Those two simple things, I think, could help us.
Thank you. Your suggestion. I hear those suggestions frequently, so I'm delighted that people here are now hearing your frustration. Yes, next question.
Hi, my name's Holly. I'm here in Sonoma, and I'm a nurse in Vallejo, so I hop on at Sears Point, and luckily have a reverse commute. So for the toll, since there's so many access points, you know, Sears Point, you have Lakeville, how is that going to work? Am I going to hop on, pay a portion of a prorated toll to Vallejo, and then when I come back, do a prorated one and get off at Sears Point? So how are we going to do the toll, given that there's so many access points on and off 37?
So I mentioned the concept of a toll road or a toll bridge, and with a bridge, you usually have one access point, right, or one at either end. And so I think you can look at both concepts, but given technology, as you've seen over the last decade or so with toll collection, you don't have toll booths anymore, you have electronic tolling, you have the ability to manage tolling during peak hours. You have the ability to manage based on how far people drive in the on the toll facility, so you can do it based on ingress and egress onto the corridor and help manage traffic that way as well. But I will defer to the United.
You may have seen this in action over in the East Bay, 680, right down in Alameda County. I mean, we in MTC are working with Caltrans and putting this technology into action, and the fast track devices are now set up so that you can see it in action right here in the Bay Area. So that technology is available.
And further?
Yeah, the technical challenge of having to tolling multiple segments is with the transponders is really, really pretty simple. So that wouldn't be a problem to administer. Our proposal, as you, to solve the congestion problem on the B segment, really think of it as a toll bridge that starts at Sears Point and ends at Mare Island. There are a few points of ingress and egress, and if some landowners were committed to preserving the access to those points, but there really isn't a lot of, really isn't that many places you can go between those two points and travel off. So we put a gantry probably in there on the Mare Island side and toll, offer one toll one way.
So it would be like $5 one way, $5 the other way.
Yeah, just one way. Dan, could you comment? Is this the trend? Is this the future of California? Will all of our roads become toll roads?
Well, I would expect all the roads to
be able to have flexibility on the financing side combined with the media need.
Your mic's not on.
Well, maybe you guess. Yeah. See if it's. There it is.
How's that?
No.
I guess the other one.
Speak up.
We're good.
Hi again, I'm Dan McLean, Chief Deputy Director for Caltrans. And no, we don't want to toll every road, of course. We've had some very good experiences, as Chair McKenzie mentioned, on express lanes and the express lane programs in the Bay Area. The opportunity to convert carpool lanes and give the capacity that's available to those who are willing to pay through the fast track. So that's a great technology, even for when you switchable tags are here now for 2 and 3 riders for those reduced carpool rates. And in the future, any opportunity that we have to bring in a finance package that gives us, and we talked about 2088, current financing and funding that we have would take us to 2088 to do what we want to do. That's not practical. So if we have private-public partnerships that give us this opportunity, this is the window we need. As much local, regional, and state support as possible to make this happen and relieve Route 37's issues.
And I want to reiterate the only certainty that we now have regarding bay level rise is that it's happening faster than anybody predicted a couple of years ago. We still don't know the levels, but at BCDC it could be anywhere from 6 to 10 feet in certain areas. With the bay level rise and the king tide phenomenon. Yes?
My name is Brian Noyes. I'm a longtime resident of Sonoma County. I want to apologize for my further outburst, but knowing that this is a public forum on 37, you could expect a little bit of static, I imagine. My question is about the allocation of funding for Bay Area roads and that it's based on residents of the counties. Now, a person can live in Sonoma County and use less than 1,000 miles per year, in essence, in travel. But a person can live in Yolo County and use 37 every single day to travel to one of the highest cost of living and, you know, most lucrative job markets across the shortest amount of distance to one of the lower cost of living areas of California. Not the lowest, but given the differential between the amount of money you can make working in Marin and also in San Francisco, and the amount of money you have to spend living in Solano and Yolo, it seems to me that Highway 37 is far more important as a corridor, commuter corridor, than any other freeway in Sonoma County, or perhaps, maybe not far more important, but the point is.
Perhaps your question is, are we going to see changes in the revenue allocations and the ways to raise the revenue than our current system?
Right, yeah, based on travel to work rather than on residents.
Just a quick fact. So about 250 vehicles a day use the Marin Sonoma Narrows, and about 40,000 a day use Highway 37. So I would fully agree with your comments about the link between employment and housing costs, and that this corridor represents you've seen it explode in the last 5 years in terms of the use of 37 for that exact reason. Insufficient housing at costs that people can bear in Sonoma and Marin, affordable housing in Solano and Yolo. But, kind of order of magnitude, I just wanted to make that observation. The funding formula discussion is one that it's pretty challenging. I mean, it is tilting at windmills, because when you've got population bases like Orange County or Los Angeles or the Inland Empire, or you don't have the votes to change those things, even though you've got good arguments about the economy and so, or about jobs and housing and imbalances there. I don't know if you want to jump in on this or not, but the formula discussion comes up regularly, and we regularly complain about it, and then it really stays the same. Where we do pretty well, though, is when we have a good project and we make good arguments, and we fight above our weight in that regard. When we have a quality project like Highway 101, we could make good arguments for. Highway 37, we're going to be able to make good arguments for when there are competitive funds available. That's a key point. We haven't had statewide competitive funds since Prop 1B, which was in 2006. So we've gone now 11 years with no real opportunity to demonstrate that we've got a good project that needs attention.
And I'll just add to that, with Suzanne Smith and James Cameron and the project managers that we have in Sonoma County Transportation Authority, we've, as the box in the boxing world would say, punched above our weight for a long time. We're ready. We know how to work with Caltrans. We've developed a relationship with District 4 that I'll challenge anybody else to match in any part of California. So if we get the chance to compete and we'll do well, but we're not at that point right at this moment in time.
David, do you have anything to add? I think you probably already iterated why it's so important for us to continue to be a self-help county.
Well, I think in Suzanne and James and the whole SETA crew has done a great job, like I mentioned before, on 101, leveraging those dollars 5, 6, 7 to 1. I mean, I don't think you can do much better than that. And that's why it's that. But that wouldn't have happened without the seed money, which is the Measure M, self-help money going forward. And I think the reason, having shovel-ready projects, and you always hear that as well. Petaluma River Bridge, for instance, came along out of contract savings elsewhere in the state or in the district, and all of a sudden, dollars turned up and we were ready to go because we had made the initial investment.
And now made Costa County didn't get these dollars because we were ready.
But that was because we were, again, ready to go because we had that seed money, and I think we obviously have been very successful that way. We need to continue that, and that's why it's important to have Measure M.
And we know here in the Valley that the intersection of 116 and 121 continues to be a choke point coming out of the Valley, both from Napa and Sonoma. That also will be in queue with a potential reauthorization of Measure M. Yes?
Hi. My name is Kendall Webster, and I'm here on behalf of the Sonoma Land Trust. Wendy Elliott wishes she was here. She's sick. So she gave me a comment to present and also a question to ask. The comment goes, as many of you know, Sonoma Land Trust has been working to conserve and restore the lands and waters along Highway 37 since the 80s. We've partnered with federal, state, and local agencies and nonprofits to protect more than 6,500 acres and restore more than 1,000 acres. We did receive calls this winter from commuters and residents wondering if our tidal wetland restoration project at Sears Point led to the flooding near Novato Creek. And fortunately, our work was nowhere near the site and it did not have any influence there. In fact, without more restoration and wholesale changes to the highway, we are going to see more flooding. The highway sits in the middle of the historic marsh, like was discussed, and is largely at or below sea level. We strongly believe that any fixes to 37 not be band-aid fixes, but ones that assume and take into account sea level rise and increasing storm surge. Raising the highway seems to be the proper course. To this effect, we have been active participants in the UC Davis and Caltrans study, and we attend the 37 policy committee meetings. We are also preparing to launch a new initiative in the lower Sonoma Creek area, which already suffers chronic flooding and groundwater issues. Changes to Highway 37 will be a major part of any solution in Lower Sonoma Creek, and we are committed to working with our partners, including all of you, to develop lasting solutions there to increase resilience against the change that is coming. So the question is, how can we implement an inclusive process that integrates Highway 37 planning and marsh restoration to better ensure resilience into the future?
And Eliza and Isaac, perhaps you might take the first stab at this, since BCDC is, as you described, already working on restoration strategies. Thank you, Kendall, and my best to Wendy. we may have to pass this microphone down, or you're welcome to come up here. I'm not sure why it's not working. Maybe we can get some, Michael or May. Is anybody here to help us get a microphone to work? I'll let Pat deal with that. So sorry.
So I can take a first shot at this, and then Eliza, if you have some comments too. So I think the question was how can we build a resilient partnership across a lot of different agencies regarding Highway 37 and incorporated marsh restoration. And I think there's a lot of opportunities out there. A couple of people tonight have talked about Measure AA, and that's gonna definitely be provide a lot of funding for restoration, and that will provide a lot of opportunities to what we call a BCDC multi-benefit projects. So ones that provide environmental benefits as well as flood protection benefits. And then I guess the last thing I would say before anyone else wants to is, I think another important factor is a little bit about what we talked about and just in terms of regional collaboration, because large transportation projects like Highway 37 and other ones that, as I mentioned, we're going to be assessing with our grant from Caltrans across the Bay Area, those require significant collaboration efforts, and it can't just be one agency, it can't just be one county. So I think in addition to, you know, the design challenges and the funding challenges, it's also a collaboration challenge. And I think the opportunities like our Adapting to Rising Tides program and how we approach collaborative adaptation planning is something significant and an opportunity, I think, for all the people, all the agencies, and as I said, the citizens as well, to participate in this process. So,
thanks so much. Why don't you pass it down?
If I can, I just add, I think I see Grant Davis from the Sonoma County Water Agency here. We were at a meeting this morning with some representatives from Marin County talking specifically about Novato Creek and the maintenance of Novato Creek. The Novato Flood Control District is looking to put a measure on the ballot. They're doing some polling to see how successful they will be. But one of the things they want to do is to take Novato Creek or do some flood maintenance of Novato Creek east on the eastern side of Novato and down in the floodplain area, do some detention. Certainly, I think in the this series of events, being, pardon my pun, a perfect storm, one of the things that was apparent was Novato Creek is probably carrying about 10% of its capacity. Now, it doesn't mean that the road wouldn't have closed otherwise, maybe a few less days, who knows, but that's an issue. Certainly at 121, 116, the Sonoma Creek has similar issues, and it's becoming much more difficult to get into the creeks and do that maintenance and the prohibitions because of the different regulatory agencies and everything else. And Supervisor Gorin and I are trying to do a spearhead, a little pilot program. We had actually one creek, Copeland Creek, on the edge of both of our districts jump its watershed that usually flows into the Russian River watershed, decided to come across the road, wipe the road out, and almost stranded, 200 residents, and join the Petaluma watershed, which then ends up flooding down in Pengrove. So we're constantly trying to deal with these things, and I know that was interesting the other day, seeing the way, you know, a lot of our flood maintenance was based on technology and things from the 50s, which is not the way we want to do things anymore, but at the same time, working through the hydrology and really trying to move that amount of water is always a challenge. So, you know, it's a matter of resources there as well, and but we're, like Novato, looking to augment that.
Ed or Linda, do you want to comment further about the environmental benefits of your proposal?
So when we started looking at the overall solution for this section, the first place we started was talking to environmental groups and agencies to determine what would be the best approach to help with the flow in the areas and how to preserve the environment through the region. So the elevated structure, being able to be high enough where we can accommodate sea level rise for whatever time period, because this will be there for more than 150 years. And, you know, being able to accomplish it with a build from the top technique that preserves the environment. So that would be part of our solution.
Is that for the entire corridor?
The question was, would that be for the entire corridor? Through talking with various environmental specialists, they have recommended that a certain portion of it would need to be all elevated, and then a certain portion would be an elevated roadway that would serve kind of as a berm, as an additional protection in that particular zone. So that would be worked out with environmental permitting, and we would accomplish it based on what comes out of that process.
And Kendall, I'm sure you could come up afterwards and ask some more questions.
Yes.
Richard Moss in Sonoma, two questions. Would Caltrans consider revising the 37-121 interchange to get rid of the stoplight by putting in two flyovers that would have more or less continuous traffic? So you would have one eastbound on 37 to northbound on 121, and the other from southbound 121 to eastbound 17. I think that would, you know, it's not going to make the 2-to-1 issue perfect, but at least
it will improve the intersection there. And I think Dan can comment as well as maybe Susanna, David.
Thank you for your question. Again, you're talking about the 37-121 intersection.
By the raceway.
Yeah, so yes, we'll take another look at it. I also drive the 37 corridor quite a bit. And I've got some new ideas even from today. So we have a great traffic engineering staff, so we'll work closely with Suzanne and her staff and see if we can flip the queue for take a look at what's going on with the signals and get some information back.
Because I don't know what the cost would be, but obviously that would improve the flow.
We're having some queuing issues there now. Maybe it's a capacity issue, or maybe it's the restriping. But we've had that conversation with Caltrans, and Caltrans has been pretty responsive in meeting with me to talk about operational improvements along Highway 12 and 121.
My second question is, could the state, would it make any difference if we renamed it 3780 or some version of 80 so that it could be part of the interstate highway system?
I love that. We like a little humor in these discussions, but Dan, I don't think that is going to happen.
Well, I like that follow-up. That was very good. Thank you. I did want to say that it was a great comment earlier. I will work with Paul Fontana of the California Highway Patrol from the Golden Gate Division about some of the cut-ins and see what he can do for enhanced enforcement, and work closely with our traffic engineering group to see. I know they've, as Supervisor Gorin said, they've studied this and made changes over the years, so it might be time to make some adjustments there. Thank you.
Great, thanks. Hi, Bill, next question.
So Bill Bloom, I'm a Sonoma Valley resident, also had the pleasure of being at the United Bridge Partners presentation last May, so that's a 30-month project, so if we had done it right then, we'd be only 19 months away, having an elevated roadway. But it sounds like, first, I think having design plans done, really going forward with that, and having the four counties working together, it looks like we're moving in a positive direction. And I hate to say that the flooding of 37 was probably a good thing, because at that meeting last year when we didn't have that, we were told the thing that was the most discouraging was that no plans were on the board for 37 until, as you mentioned, 2088. So this will hopefully help speed it up. We were on national news talking about the first incident of the rising tides and climate change in the United States. Really, Highway 37 was one of the first examples of that. So I think being a national issue of climate change and rising tides could really help us get funding, possibly, be creative. And my question is, two things that came out of that meeting last year. One, somebody told me Caltrans will never give up a state highway, so the United Bridge Partners will never happen. So I'm just curious how Caltrans feels about that. And then was also curious if United Bridge Partners would be interested in doing a public-private partnership, and if so, would you consider the whole 21 miles and not just 9 miles?
Thanks, Bill. Appreciate your questions. And yes, you're right. I actually was saying about the flooding, I'm really sad it's closed, and I'm really happy because it does elevate the discussion. Okay, so who wants to address that first? This is going back and forth.
I'm going to let Dan off the hook because I don't think Caltrans is uninterested in relinquishing highways that are costly and going to be so in the future. But the risk reward discussion is what we have as local policymakers who sit here, as state officials responsible for maintaining access and good, you know, functioning facilities. The discussion of risk reward is really what we're talking about, and how we do our due diligence to figure out what the risks are and what the values are of doing something new. And this is new. And I like to be second in a lot of things. Being first can be, you know, it brings its challenges. So we're, you know, that's part of what we're doing with our design alternatives analysis and that sort of thing, is making sure that our local electeds and our state folks have good information with which to make a decision about potentially relinquishing the road. I mean, there's a lot of positive things about this, the United Bridge Partners approach. We just need to figure out functionally what can work or what the hurdles are and if they are surmountable. But I don't think it's on Caltrans not wanting to relinquish a roadway conceptually.
Dan?
No, I got it.
Of course.
I never want to relinquish a mic. I did talk about this a wee bit, and Suzanne Smith expressed my feelings as an elected official serving on MTC, looking at taking on ownership of Highway 37/80, or however you wish to name it, and that is there are risks, but we've not been risk averse, I don't think, always. I don't know. You don't want to be first. I think in this instance, one of the big successes of the four county working policy group has been to bring the four counties together to get us to treat this as a serious problem. I indicated earlier on, there had not been engineering studies done on 37 in any depth whatsoever, looking at merges, whatever, you know, syndrome you want to talk about. So this is something that we are going to grapple with, and if it requires us to get legislation to take over ownership of 37, so be it. I'll even accede to the fact that it might be a grand P3 project to be working with United Bridge Partners, but I don't know how they feel about P3 projects.
And how do you feel about it? Comments before we bring it back to Dan?
Oh, sorry.
We're obviously coming to the top of our time commitment here, so I'll briefly, we recognize there's a problem, in particular on the A segment. It's something we'd be willing to fund to both study and potentially solve. I don't and think and am generally not a fan of a traditional P3 concession model, which is why we've structured this proposal in a slightly different way, and I think that different structure could accommodate a solution for the entire corridor.
And Dan?
If I could just add one thing.
Of course.
Because as chair of the Four County Committee, it's an unusual circumstance to have a private entity come and say they're going to build a road for you and go through this process. This has not happened, as far as I know, in our neck of the woods. You know, I think it's incumbent upon us as public officials to do our due diligence. And that's exactly what we're trying to do, is to go down that path. And, you know, I think there's undoubtedly some frustration at some points in time about how you actually do that. How do you actually, you know, I'm sure, I can't speak for United Bridge, but they would love a letter of intent, exclusive arrangement, and off we go. How do we know there's not a better, quite frankly, how do we know that's the best deal that's out there if we go that route? How do we know how that compares to what we do with the BATA or another method? And I think that's what we're trying to do, and the corridor study is part of that. We're trying to make sure that we do our due diligence and do it as expeditiously as possible, because we know Obviously, time is of the essence with the roadway the way it is, certainly this year. And I'll let Dan talk about the deed to the road.
Dan, are you anxious to see this highway go away?
I think we're all anxious to see something happen. Over the years, Route 37 may have not gotten the respect that it deserved. Priority-wise, statewide, and regionally, we've had a lot of challenges, as you know. But a lot of those challenges are complete, and so it's great that four counties are coming together. That helps us a lot. Over the years, we've had transportation concept reports and some regular looks at what 37 could be, but now with 41,000 vehicles a day and the growing economy and this opportunity. So we're all looking at this table and in this room for the opportunity to do something great on Route 37. It's an environmental, it used to be considered an environmental impact to even widen a foot. This is an environmental opportunity. Those historical marshes, as BCDC staff has mentioned, and Sonoma Land Trust, we have an opportunity to free up those marshes with causeway in certain areas. We have an opportunity to, as Suzanne mentioned, climate resiliency is three steps. Consider adapting, defending, or retreating. Well, you can adapt side slopes, so it enhances the environment. So it's a really an environmental opportunity. It's a traffic congestion opportunity. And if we can all come up with a package where we could design, build, operate, maintain, and finance, whatever the package is, we're going to help make it happen.
All right. Those are great words. Thank you so much, Dan. Next question. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 more. We're going to do lightning rounds. A quick question, quick answer, so we can get through. Yes, that will include the panel. They're elected officials. That's a problem.
Well, we may all collapse.
Go ahead.
My name is Mike Say. I'm from Napa, and I have about 40 years of experience in transportation planning, also public transit. So I have 3 points. I suggest if anybody's interested, there's a website called citylab.com, which is run by the Atlantic Magazine. It's citylab.com, and there's an article in today, yesterday, on the 4th, yesterday, about what happened after the collapse of the freeway in Atlanta. Turns out, the public transit agency, the ridership has gone up about 25 to 30%, which is like 60 to 70,000 people a day, which compares to the traffic on that road, which is the way of 250,000. So my guess is a lot of traffic just disappeared, or people are staying more in their local areas if they didn't have to commute in that corridor. So I'm concerned that this whole thing is depending on, at least what the bridge partners are proposing, is depending on a growth in traffic. And I'm not sure, number one, that will occur if you have a toll. Number two, I'm not sure that without the growth in traffic, you'd ever get the money to do the second, replacing the existing embankment, assuming they could build. I think there's enough money in that to build the first bridge.
Thank you. Appreciate that. Do you have a question?
I just have a question in the sense, I mean, what is that depending on?
What are our projections on a vehicle usage? And we're in a quandary because the things are changing. I just was talking with our transit director, and this is being experienced Bay, perhaps nationwide. More people are using Uber and Lyft. And so our ridership is really coming down. But who has the projections?
The short answer, our proposal is not dependent on growth in traffic the way that I think you're asking. And the financial model does support the second strip. The second
strip. I mean, you're talking about well over $1 billion project.
Thank you. Or minimum, yes. Thank
the traffic
you.
Is already grown.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
You could increase the traffic by eliminating the 121 intersection.
Okay.
That'll give you 40 or 50% more capacity. And I also wonder why we haven't been looking at using the rail line, which is a $200 million project.
That has been suggested as part of the consideration.
Do a lot of talking, and the public needs the opportunity to speak as well, if you excuse me, madam.
Thank you. Steve.
Steve Page, Sonoma resident, also the Center Point Raceway, Sonoma Raceway guy. Got my name wrong. I want to first answer the question about the barrier that we put up. For those of you who are unfamiliar with the situation, a lot of people that are headed eastbound on 37 will make a left turn on 121, make a U-turn in the Raceway driveway, and then go back and turn left. And it's problematic because there are a lot of people who do some really crazy things in our driveway. We had a lot of wrecks with our employees. I was almost hit several times, and with our tenants. So we put up a barrier that would require people to come all the way in and go through our gate in order to make a U-turn. And what we found is that it induced even crazier behavior. People didn't come all the way up to our gate. They would pull into the inbound lane, make a U-turn there, almost collide with traffic that was coming southbound or turning in, and it caused more problems than it created. So we had to take it out just because we were having a lot of accidents. The Highway Patrol will come out and park in our driveway on occasion. They'll pull people over and make them spend some time producing their registration and all that. They can't ticket them for making a U-turn on private property. And the citations they have given, the court has thrown out. So that preventing that behavior, we have not found a way to do it. So that's an issue that it's just a daily problem. And some of the people who are doing that are jerks. Most of them are just people who are frustrated and angry and wanting to figure out a way to spend a few more minutes with their families because they can't afford to live in the communities where they work. I wasn't going to make a comment, but because you, Suzanne and David and Susan, have heard everything I'm about to say, and Jake, I'd be happy to return your phone call anytime if you'd like me to bend your ear on it. But
I'll be happy to talk to you on the phone.
I'm not an engineer. It took me 8 years to get through college, but I did master arithmetic, and four into two into one is the basic problem here. There are environmental problems, there are flood control problems, but the basic problem from Sears Point to Vallejo is a capacity problem, and the only way we solve that capacity is by adding more lanes. I've been very impressed with what I've seen from United Bridge Partners. I don't think anybody should be handing them a blank check. Nobody would suggest that the agencies and the public not do their due diligence to make sure that they're not making obscene profits on the backs of low-income commuters who are traveling through that corridor every day. But there is a solution that's there and available and ready, and 101 is the priority for lots of good reasons, and Suzanne deserves a lot of credit for what's happened over the last 10 years. Those of you who are familiar with two lanes all the way through Santa Rosa and the progress we've made there is phenomenal. The money that's going to come our way is going to go to 101. It's not going to 37. There's got to be a toll road is really the only way that's going to get solved. And if we look at the public assuming the risk and look at the experience we had with the Bay Bridge and have an opportunity to have a private entity assume that risk, I think that we're looking at an opportunity we should be looking at very carefully.
Thanks, Steve. Hi, your next question.
Hi, I'm Lydia. I'd like to say, David, your last answer, I don't even have a comment. You answered it so perfectly. I think I would like to add to your answer, though, in that diligence process, when there's a note, and you guys are brilliant. I want to see this. I believe in toll roads, but you have to do A first. So we're taking on the burden of Solano County. There's nothing in that for the 121 corridor. The give back is Solano County has to participate so we can participate with Marin County. Because Marin County, we're their Solano County, correct? We know this from working on SMART. We need to get train transportation. We need to get, if we could get the ferry at Black Point, we've got a win-win. Vallejo has a ferry from all the way down there. So part of this brilliant innovation has to do Section A first. Because otherwise you're pulling all that traffic. Now, my husband's lived there for 60 years. He was born on that southern tip of Sonoma County. Our son, we have two ranches, the one we live on and the one that our kids will live on. So we see, I've been there for almost 40 years, I've been married there. So we see that traffic, we've seen the changes, but prior to the 50s, maybe their hydraulics was bad, but their transportation was good. There was a trail station, or a rail station, station on H Street. There was one that went to Black Point. Sonoma and the Southern Corridor is disconnected. What do I want to see living there? I'm open to the all the tourism. I want to see that for Sonoma County, but I want to be able to catch public transportation where I live. And I'm that close to San Francisco. So I don't believe we're ready for B until you solve A, or you're just pushing all that traffic to the 121 corridor. Thank you for your time.
Thanks, Linda. I tried to suggest before that we do have rail tracks coming through here. David serves on the SMART board. They're trying desperately. And Jake, I always forget about Jake. They're trying desperately to get a train up and running. But I think you're absolutely right, and that the future of SMART will be coming east through Sonoma, Napa, and connecting to the Capitol Corridor. We may not live to see it, but I'm a cheerleader for it. Yeah, but we have to elevate the tracks. They're just as much at risk as the highway.
Look at it as
Thanks, Linda.
Look
appreciate
at
it.
Project.
Hi.
Hi, my name is Tushan Madon. I'm a resident of Sonoma. I've been traveling 20 years on 37 commuting in San Francisco, and my frustration level has gone up to here. And I'm not going to fault you personally, but I'm going to fault Caltrans personally. I don't think they have done nothing in 20 years. They haven't tried to make a Sonoma-only lane, a Lakeville-only lane, something, anything. They drag their feet. I've called them up. I've written emails. I've suggested different ideas. Nothing is being done. Until now, but it's 20 years I've been driving on this road and nothing can be done in 20 years. Some small thing. Can we have like, let's pave the middle of the median on 37 going up Lakeville, make a Lakeville only lane so people can go up and put K up barriers on the side so they can't, only those people can go that way. Help Sonoma out. All these people coming down from Sacramento, the Uber drivers, the Lyft drivers, all the people who want to come down and work to San Francisco, just like I do, and just the road can't take it. It's just so many people. Thank you.
I'm glad you're not blaming Dan. He's a good guy.
No, I just think, really think it's the whole mentality, the whole mentality of Caltrans. Just these people get it, they will get it done. I'm a total believer in privatization. To get the people like that, because we didn't have privatization way in the beginning due to Transcontinental Railroad. It never would have been built. We need people like them doing it. Our public agencies are big bureaucratic messes, and they are not doing anything for us. You guys do it.
Thank you so much. This will be our final question. We appreciate everybody's patience, and thanks so much.
Thanks, Brian, again. I just want to say it's my birthday. I showed up here for ringside seats. I'm surprised that it hasn't been a little
Happy
bit
birthday.
More contentious. Thank you. Three quick questions, one quick answer, two other perhaps open-ended later.
Quickly, one question.
First question, what's the timeline in a matter of years for your proposal in privatization? And second question, given all the development restrictions in Sonoma and Marin counties, don't the residents at least in a moral sense, owe some kind of premium for the transportation funds that are going to be needed for a corridor to bring the people who work in their stores where they shop, and leave and spend 2 hours on the road to live
Thank
somewhere
you.
Else cheaper?
Thank you.
Third question, can we evaluate the cost of two-lane expansion and a Richmond Bridge-style double-level causeway with a underground rail running underneath the whole thing?
Thanks so much. Really briefly, a lot of questions probably we can't answer, but two decks.
Yes, the time frame, upon a signed agreement, we would get busy on permitting and we would have the entire project done in less than 5 years.
Okay, any other responses? I
I think it's an interesting thought as to who should pay for what in this world. And if we could figure that out as to who pays for the cost of doing what, then we could all go home happy. I haven't worked this one out yet.
Once again, please join me in thanking our panelists here tonight. Lots of information, and I will remind you, thank you, KSVY, for televising tonight. They will be broadcasting this on their station, and you can view it if you log on to their website. Thank you. Drive safely. Hopefully, few of you have to use Highway 37 to get home. Thanks so much.
No way.